Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And in this episode, we'll be concluding our review of Season 3 of Rebels. Before we get into Hera, Kanan, and the rest adventures, Jay, where can our listeners find us around the internet?
All right, Dennis, we are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
Okay, the dish is aligned, the signal is boosted to maximum output, the shield's down, we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. This is our discussion of Rebels Zero Hour Part 2, which is Episode 22 of Season 3. Yeah, kind of had this one on the simmering here for like a month and a half or so. So sorry about that. It's just with the way our recording schedule went with all of our travel and then Kenobi coming out, it was just kind of hard to fit this in.
Right, and Celebration and everything else coming out of Celebration. So, yeah, it happens.
Right. So, we got this and then 10 episodes of Season 4 and we're done with Rebels. I can't believe it.
Right. So,
but without any further ado, why don't we go ahead and get in our discussion here? And that always starts with our summary. So, Jay, you want to go ahead and give that to us, please?
Absolutely. Thrawn has Hera and the Rebels cornered on Adalon and commences his attack. Meanwhile, on Crownest, Ezra convinces Sabine's mother to send reinforcements to aid Hera. Just as Thrawn corners Hera, the Bendu attacks, providing an opening for the Rebels to escape the planet. At the same time, Ezra and the Mandalorians take down the Imperial Interdictor, and the rebellion escapes from Thrawn and the Empire.
Right, so that is the conclusion to Season 3. What do you think about it overall?
Well, I was so happy to get back into this. Let me just tell you, and I know we just talked right before we got started, and it's always sitting in that, you know, watch next kind of a thing. So it was so wonderful to get back into it. And I had forgotten how much of just about everything is teetering on this episode in terms of getting Sabine to come back, how they got her to come back, and how they got her and the other Mandalorians to come to their aid. Just the fact that they lost it all there on Adalon, and this is showing how they regrouped with the rest of the rebellion, which leads us right into where Rogue One is. And that's where I kind of had to have my brain pan lined up a little bit too, is just remembering where in the actual timeline, you know, like real life timeline, this series was in correlation to where, you know, when Rogue One was coming out. And so it was just kind of a fun thing to relive. Great to see people like Thrawn, you know, back in action again and just doing his darndest to try to thwart everybody. The Bendu, which, as you know, I kind of have a love-hate relationship with. But I understand, you know, a little bit more after watching, especially after watching Rebels Recon, kind of where his purpose lies, I guess you could say. But overall, it was a great episode to get back into and a very fitting end to this particular season. So what about you?
No, I think you said it all there. I think it is a fitting conclusion to the season. I remember the first time I saw this, I was mildly surprised that Thrawn was still around because they had been kind of closing off villains on a season by season basis prior to this. No, there's only two seasons before this, but you know, it was the Grand Inquisitor at the end of season one. It was the other Inquisitors at the end of season two. And, you know, they introduced Maul, you know, was around, and now we have Thrawn, and Thrawn's still around and kicking. So that was, I remember at the time, kind of surprised that they weren't going into yet another direction. And it, and I'm thankful for that because it kind of got this away from the serialized 80s cartoons type of a thing, where, you know, as a villain of the season or a villain of the week type of a deal. And so Thrawn got to hang around and bedevil our heroes for another season of the show, or half a season anyway, as season four turns out to be. So the episode starts off with Thrawn and the Empire in orbit, and Hera gets Rex and Zeb to raise the shield that Sabine had recovered earlier in the season, and they get it working just in time, and it manages to hold up under the bombardment. But it seems like just when the shield is about to go out, that's when Thrawn elects to call off the bombardment and send in the troops. I mean, if he had just had them, you know, more, as Colin Wimmer has said, for another minute or two, he might have just destroyed the entire Phoenix Squadron right there.
Right. Well, do you think that he did that purposely? Or do you think he just didn't know that their shield was holding that well?
You know, that's a good question, and it's hard to say, because he tells his officers, like, they've had enough. And I mean, well, enough what? They're not destroyed. You know, what's your point? And now, the only other thing I can think of is that towards the end of the episode, he does instruct the troops to try and capture the officers and take them alive. And so maybe that's what he was hoping for, is that he's kind of worn them down, and now he's going to give himself the opportunity to take prisoners that he can use to capture the rest of the rebellion.
Because that was, for me, a little out of character, I guess, you know, as far as Thrawn is concerned, because we've seen him being very relentless when it comes to his pursuits. So for him to just, oh, they've had enough, you know, kind of took me aback a little bit. And I had forgotten about that. That's why I asked.
Yeah, and I think there's two explanations for that. One is that, or a couple, he didn't realize how strong their shield was, and that was about to fail, and it just wasn't working, so it's time to go on to the next thing. Two, he wanted to take someone alive, and completely just bombarding the whole base with turbo laser fire from space wasn't going to permit that to happen in the long run. Or three, it was just a, you know, the better way of going about it is a ground assault. So anyway, I think those are all possibilities there, and well, don't really have a way of knowing for certain, but moving along in the story. So Ezra and Chopper get to Cronest, and Sabine is surprised to see them. We discover that the Mandalorians are now in open civil war, and Ursa Wren's faction is being opposed by Gar Saxon. And so, you know, that conflict story has been told in earlier episodes this season. And Ursa and the family keep saying things like, as much as we want to help, we can't, we just don't have the resources, which sounds exactly, or almost exactly, like what Mon Mothma just told them at the end of the last episode. But Ezra and Sabine press the point, and Ursa Wren says, well, Ezra and his companions made it possible that I could reunite with my daughter, so I'd like to repay that favor, and I'm not going to order anyone to go, but anyone who wants to go aid you can. And they come away with a nice little task force for that. But what do you think about this portion here and Ursa Wren's generosity?
Well, you know, it's, for her, she's walking a really thin tightrope between trying to preserve her way in Mandalore and trying to overcome Gar Saxon, and then also her relationship with Sabine. So I think part of the reason why she wanted to go to their aid was, yes, they did help her, but I think it's also because she wanted to further establish that bond, that trust with her daughter as well. And so, yeah, I think it was really cool that there were so many of them that did end up saying, hey, we're going to go help, because I mean, this is the Empire you're talking about, you know, and they just had gone to blows with the Empire in a major way. And so why would you want to reopen that wound, kind of a thing? So I just thought it was great that they were able to do that. But what about you?
Well, let me follow what you just set up with a question. Does it say anything about the rebellion that Mon Mothma could not be talked into sending anyone to help out Phoenix Squadron, yet it didn't take that much convincing for the Mandalorians to send somebody to help.
That's a good point. But then again, we're talking about Mandalorians too. So I guess there's part of me thinks that, you know, just the code, the way of the Mandalorians, not to say this is the way, but just their whole culture is one of, that's what they do. You know what I mean? And I think that at this point, especially with Mon Mothma, she is very afraid of utilizing too many of her resources and also kind of coming out in the open with too many of them, almost like revealing your hand too quickly. And so, yeah, and that's definitely at the detriment of not being able to help those that actually need it. But that's a great point.
Yeah, I mean, I guess the other part is that having watched a lot of Clone Wars lately and the Mandalorian episodes that were involved, is that the Mandalorians were always so insular when it came down to it. You know, they were always concerned about what is going on at home. And that's the point Ursa raises, to the point where they were trying to remove themselves from the greater galactic conflict. Yet the rebellion is all about restoring the Republic and courting allies and supporting those allies. But, you know, last thing we heard from Mon Mothma was like, I'm sorry, I can't send anyone, but I'll try to negotiate good treatment for you all. Like, that's nothing. That's good. That's good for nothing. The, you know, what do you have to bargain with? Nothing, Mon, when it comes down to it. So some of the thoughts that occurred to me on all of that. But I don't know that really says anything other than just that was the circumstances at the time, and the rebellion was on shaky ground and really couldn't afford to expose themselves any further. But there we are. So Thrawn starts the assault, the ground assault, I should say, on Adalon, and Zeb and Rex mine one of the approaches, which is very effective in taking out the ATDP walkers. They're trying to come through, and then the AT-ATs arrive. And which was fun. The fun part about this was that, you know, Kanan had got caught outside of the shield because he was on his way back from the Bendu. And when he made contact with Hera, she was very, very relieved. And all of Rebels has been kind of had this question floating in the background about, is there more to the relationship with Kanan and Hera? What did you think about their discussion here when she expresses so much relief that he still survived? And it's like, you know, get back here as soon as you can, love. And
yes,
I mean, it was, we've heard in the past kind of Vanessa's explanation for that. You know, it's kind of like that British cheeky, you know, do what you have to do, love, type of thing. It's a term of endearment for anybody. But it seemed a bit more than that in this case.
Yes, it definitely seemed a lot more pointed. And I think, too, that we are getting to see, especially at this point in time where the stakes are getting so much higher, that there is almost an urgency to make sure that everyone understands how much each other means to them. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, there was even that one point where even Kanan kind of says offhandedly, well, the family's back together again. But Hera says, yes, let's try to keep it that way. You know, so there's almost this desperation that's getting started. And so I think that the facade, if there was anyone, you know, any facade up to begin with, is starting to really drop, you know, and it's like go time now. So why hide these feelings and why keep them, you know, under wraps any longer when who knows how much longer we may have?
Right, right. And so Thrawn presses the attack. The AT-ATs show up. I really love the moment when Kanan comes charging back down that ravine and takes out an AT-AT at the legs with his lightsaber. That was such a cool maneuver there. The battle above Adalon continues with the Mandalorians arriving, and they are going to target the interdictor, and they're going to go with kind of a surface assault on it, which when I was watching this, I couldn't help but think about the attack on the Star Destroyer during the Rise of Skywalker.
Yes.
When they were going to take out the transmitter by using the Orbex that Jaina and her friends had. And, you know, BB-8 and Finn joined them, and Rose was there, and they, you know, they took the fight to the surface of that Star Destroyer. But what did you think about this plan to do this space surface assault on the Interdictor?
Well, first of all, we're always of the same mind, because I thought the exact same thing. And I thought to myself, I wonder if this is where the inspiration for that actually came from. And so here's all the Mandalorians, and then there's Ezra with his little spacesuit, and Sabine's talking about how they're going to use their jetpacks, and he's like, but I don't have a jetpack. And she goes, but you have those little thruster thingies. Mm-hmm. And you know, I thought it was very cunning and also brave and very smart for them to do that, because again, you know, you get in close and you're the small one, and they can't touch you when you're that small. And so, you know, it was definitely a gamble, but it's something that I feel like the Mandalorians just happen to, you know, they just do. That's just what they do, is they take those chances and they roll those dice. But what were your thoughts?
Well, I'm not sure I was ever clear why it had to be done that way, as opposed to using those Mandalorian starfighters and just assaulting the Interdictor, because they didn't seem to be having any trouble with the TIE fighters that were pursuing them, and they were doing a good job evading the fire of the Star Destroyers. So just this notion that it had to be this type of assault, other than the fact that it's a cool story, I'm just not sure I understood the necessity of doing it that way. But it worked. It was fun seeing Ezra do a spacewalk with his lightsaber. Shades of Ahsoka and Anakin in Clone Wars doing similar assaults. That was pretty cool.
Oh, yeah. And I noticed he was using his lightsaber with his left hand and shooting with his right hand. Mm-hmm. So I guess I don't know if that was just something that he's always done. Has he always been kind of left-handed, or is he just, you know, that ambidextrous? I guess I never really paid attention.
I don't know. I mean, if I had to guess, you know, I'm right-handed. If I was going to be shooting and wielding another weapon, I definitely want the projectile weapon in my right hand, because that's my dominant side. Mm-hmm. You know, and the lightsaber was kind of almost more defense, kind of acting as a shield in that way. So mm-hmm. I guess that's the only thing I can come up with. I have never really kept track of whether he was left-handed or right-handed or not. Now that you mention it, that's a good point.
Hmm. We should ask Dave.
Right. So ultimately that's a successful, and they take down the Interdictor that way. But it's not before Hera and the rest of the rebels get cornered on Adalon by Thrawn, and he's insisting on their surrender. And Thrawn notices that Kanan is kind of getting nervous about this approaching storm that has two big glowing spots in it. Well, we know that that's the Bindu. And so you had brought up the Bindu earlier, and this is where he really makes his presence felt. He comes charging in, screaming, you know, I am the light, I am the dark, I bring death. I am the Bindu. I mean, you want to talk about someone who likes the sound of his own name. He uses it quite a bit there. And he's destroying AT-ATs, destroying other fighters, but he's not pulling his punches where the rebellion is concerned either. He's, as far as he's concerned, everybody needs to get off his planet. But what did you think about the Bindu's arrival?
Oh, right. And I thought it was really cool the way that they did it. And I thought Rebels Recon did an awesome job of explaining how they kind of theorized and conceptualized what the Bindu was going to look like in this storm, and how they came up with the idea in his materialization, I guess you could say. So that part of it was really cool. And I thought it was funny when, you know, Kanan was getting nervous and Hera said, I thought he was your friend. Mm-hmm. Some friend this is. But yeah, you're right. You know, he's always said he was the one in the middle, and he never wanted to be bothered in the first place. He never wanted to be brought into this. So, you know, and I get the fact that he, you know, wanted to be neutral and he wanted to be left alone here on Adalon. But then, you know, like I said, part of me just wonders, well, then what's your purpose? You know, if you are this a massive force sensitive being that has the potential to do so much good, why don't you do it? I mean, I understand that he doesn't want to do anything, but why don't you want to do anything? He's like the old man that's just like, get off my lawn, mm-hmm. kind of a thing. So that's the reason that I've always kind of wondered, what purpose does the Bindu actually serve, other than to maybe be that sounding board of consciousness or conscience, I guess you could say, for people like Kanan, and then ultimately to give this foreboding warning to Thrawn.
Yeah, we'll get to the warning in just a second. But to me, the Bindu is a college philosophy class unto himself when it comes down to it, with his whole way of talking about how, you know, there's a middle path and he's that path. And it very much to me seems like he's kind of someone for predeterminism here, that his actions aren't going to make a difference in the galaxy because he is there in the middle. He's not favoring the light. He's not favoring the dark. Those things will play out around him. And he just hears the Force. He knows the dark side. He knows the light side. And that does not really speak to him having a role in galactic events. Those aren't of his concern. And, you know, Kanan's admonition in the previous episode about, you know, this is just cowardice. You sitting around with the power to do something, and I used to think like you did, and I wasn't going to get involved, but this is cowardice. I don't know that that necessarily struck a chord with the Bindu or not, other than he was annoyed that his middle path has been disrupted by both the rebellion and the Empire in this case. And if it takes getting action against the Empire to preserve his path, then that's what he's going to do. I don't know that he did it for any big altruistic motive at all in this. Yeah, I mean, it's not a satisfying answer to your question in the least bit, but there he is. Mm-hmm. But getting to this warning that he gives to Thrawn, he says to Thrawn, he's like, you don't see it, do you? I see your defeat, like many arms surrounding you in a cold embrace. And I think we know what that is at this point, because we know how the series ends. But this was one of the things that kind of hung out there forever. Everyone wondering what in the world Bindu meant by this.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, was it going to be something that was literal, you know, this cold embrace? Or was it going to be something that was a little bit more, you know, philosophical, as you were saying just a little bit ago? Because as I know, at the time, I was thinking the cold embrace would have to be something like the dark side, because we always associated, you know, everybody always said, even Anakin, you know, how feel you cold, sir? You know, and that was, mm-hmm. everyone always said that was the dark side of the Force. So was it some dark, sinister presence that was going to take him down, or, you know, something literal in that case? But I love how they did zoom in on the Bendu's eye, and you saw his eye and then Thrawn's eye. And then all you saw was down the barrel of the gun, or the blaster. And then when Thrawn shot, Bendu was gone. I thought that was cool.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I remember that confusing me the first time I saw this. Is like, wait, did he actually shoot him and then he disintegrated, or did the Bindu vanish mm-hmm. before the bolt could strike home? And I think all these years later, I believe it's the latter, that mm-hmm. the Bindu vanished before any damage could be done to him. Because I love that little chuckle that he leaves behind.
Right. Right. Me too.
Mm-hmm. And then I guess the other thing that happens is that Kallus finally breaks free of the Empire completely and is picked up by the Rebel crew. He got discovered in the last episode by Thrawn, and he's basically being held on the bridge by Governor Price. And then, Kallus kind of sasses Thrawn and then sasses Price a bit about the capability of these rebels and how he's been in their position and they're not so easy to defeat. And then when she basically says, you know, we'll take him downstairs and throw him out an airlock. This is like the heart of hashtag hot Kallus right here.
Yes.
When they're on that elevator and the stormtroopers are standing to either side of them. And then you got that little lock of hair coming down on Kallus's forehead and that grin as he looks up. And the next thing you see, he's knocked out the stormtroopers.
Right, right. And that's so great. So great. And definitely better that he had stormtroopers with him than the death troopers that were flanking Thrawn. But yeah, I loved how when he finally did get back on the Ghost after they recovered him, and Kanan really did give him that heartfelt thank you, you know, and Kallus said, thank you for coming back for me. And Kanan just said, well, thank you for sacrificing everything. And he realized how much he actually did sacrifice to become part of the rebellion, which I thought was just, it was so cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, you know, this is a good conclusion to season 3, but it really does set up quite a bit for season 4, I'm not exactly sure when we're going to get into season four here on the podcast, because I'm slightly reluctant to get started because we're not going to be able to finish it before Andor starts. Mm-hmm. So we'll have to think about that a little bit, and then we'll let everybody know in the coming weeks when we're getting ready to resume our coverage of the final season of Rebels, just because all those episodes are so important to what happens that I kind of hate to leave off at any point, but I suppose that's what's going to have to happen. We'll see.
Well, they are for sure. But the good thing is that, you know, Rebels will always be there. And I think it's definitely something that even now a lot more people are getting on board with. So it's never going to, you know, lose its freshness. That's for sure.
Indeed. Indeed. All right. Well, then I think that'll do it for this discussion of Rebels 0 Hour Part 2. Thank you all for listening to our discussion here on Podcast Stardust. We hope you've enjoyed the episode, and if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher choice. I'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune and Star Trek. And as always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star rating and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you use, especially Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, what are those social media contacts one more time?
All right, Dennis. Well, we can be easily found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest page where you can find all kinds of different boards filled with all kinds of fun stuff. And we also have a YouTube channel, which does have all of our past episodes, as well as some unboxing videos. And if you're in for some real-time chatter, you can always head on over to the RetroZap Discord page, or Discord room, I should say. And we are just one of many different shows. All the RetroZap shows have their own rooms over there, as well as some other fun geekery dedicated kinds of things. And so if you want to do that, just go to our show page and click on our community tab and you are there. And we also have a TeePublic store. If you are unaware, we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And we actually have 7 different show logo designs available, and you can pick up all kinds of things from apparel to home goods, even stickers and baby onesies. So if you need a coffee mug, a t-shirt, a tank top, a tote bag, wall tapestries, it's over there at teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And so with that, Dennis, I know that you've been trying to keep up with some things in your other Star franchise, so why don't you tell us about that?
Right, so my wife and I are talking Star Trek over on Warp Trails, which is a RetroZap podcast feed exclusive. So if you're into the new Star Trek shows that have been coming out on Paramount Plus, including Discovery, Picard, Lower Decks, and Strange New Worlds, then look for Warp Trails on your podcatcher choice. We'd love to have you join us. Jay, what is going on with cosplay?
All right. Well, right now over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, you can catch me as Hera as well as Ahsoka. And so I kind of try to change things up, you know, every other post or so, and try to spread the love around a little bit that way. And I am working on a new cosplay as well right now with Colby-Wan, and we are both working on Inquisitors. So he is working on the 5th brother and I'm working on the 4th sister. And so I will be posting some work in progress pictures very soon as we dive into that even more. So again, that's at j.snipscosplay.
All right, that'll do it for episode 437 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.